Orange Sky Audio presents Little Does She Know, If She Only Knew, Book 1, by Pamela Crane. Narrated for you by Leslie Howard and Meghan Kelly. To my husband, Craig, I better always be the one you'd go to jail for. Author's note. Each part contains a clue. Each clue tells a story. Each story unravels the mystery. Bludson Bay is a haunted town, a cursed town, a plague to all who live here. As with all curses, there was a beginning, and we're all still waiting for the wretched end. It all began with one man and a broken heart so deep that the cracks spread across time, across generations, to break many more. In the year 1817, Reginald Bludson, bursting in equal measure with youthful idealism and wanderlust, left Adams County, Ohio, and journeyed southward with no particular destination in mind. Traveling sometimes by boat, sometimes by horseback, he arrived one glorious April morning upon the coastal plains of the great state of North Carolina and knew he had found his home at last. He set about farming the rich black soil, and in his first year yielded a bountiful harvest of corn, wheat, cucumbers, and potatoes. News of this fertile region spread, luring more pilgrims like Reginald from far and wide. And Reginald welcomed all. In 2 years' time, the town had 25 houses, a blacksmith shop, and a general store. The next year it added a law office, two doctor's offices, and a one-room schoolhouse. After 4 years, the town proudly boasted two houses of worship, and a splendid courthouse was under construction. Life was good, and Reginald Bludson was at the center of it all. In the hustle and bustle, the naming of the burgeoning town had been put aside. All suggestions were considered, but when it was put to a vote, there was only one logical choice, and all settlers agreed. The town was christened Bludson Bay in Reginald Bludson's honor. He was pleased. One day, a new face arrived, a beautiful face, a gentle face, and Reginald instantly fell in love with this girl. He'd pass by her at the newly erected general store and gaze at her. He'd spire across the church aisle and smile. Then one day she approached him and spoke to him. It took several awkward moments before he found the voice to respond, but she adored his shyness as much as he adored her kindness. And soon they were constant companions. With her in possession of his heart, he built a house for her on the cliff overlooking the bay, and he took the girl to see it and proposed to her upon bended knee. Her kiss was all he needed to know that she loved him as much as he loved her. Together, they began their family, creating a home, enjoying the sunrises from their ocean view hideaway, and watching their land flourish. One baby after the next, their tiny family grew as they added one, two, three, then four children, all boys, to their happy little fold. While pregnant with the fifth, his beloved wife warned Reginald that if anything were to happen to her, he should raise the boys to be compassionate and loving like he was. He agreed. Of course he agreed to her every request as he caressed her cheek. But during the birth of his fifth boy, a fateful June 27th, his wife died during childbirth. While the baby survived, Reginald found he could no longer keep his promise. His crops wilted, his home deteriorated, and his heart cracked more each day. He grew to resent, then hate that fifth child that stole his beloved's life. And soon that hatred spilled and spread to all his children for what had become of his life. He withered into a wretched man, stooped and shrunken, filled with anguish and despair. On the one-year anniversary of his wife's death, he could no longer look at his children, for they wore his beloved's eyes, her nose, her lips, her smile. So he led them to the cliff's edge to watch the sunrise one last time. Then one by one, he pushed his sons into the watery abyss below. Then he himself leaped onto the jagged rocks, and at last, his broken body joined his broken spirit. That day, the blood of the children stained Bludson Bay red. The townsfolk saw this as grimly ironic, that the sanguine name of their founder had proven so prophetic. Yet one child survived the fall. He grew up to continue his father's legacy, eventually building a family of his own, a family cursed with death. You see, every year on the anniversary of his father's death, the townspeople felt the haunting, the pull of the cliff, and for decades after, pain plagued that very day, June 27th. Then, one day in 1986, the curse came for a young mother, and it would pull her toward that watery abyss, and eventually to her grave. Part 1. The Red Sweatshirt. Bludson Bay Police Department Police Report. Location, Bludson Bay Beach, 6th Block. Date, June 27, 1986. Lead Officer Name, Officer Martina Carello. Case Status, Open. Incident Type, Child Disappearance. Narrative. At 9:24 p.m. on Friday, June 27, 1986, I was dispatched to the 6th block of Bludson Bay Beach regarding a missing child. The mother, Ginger Mallowan, reported that her 16-month-old son, Cal Mallowan, went missing from the beach for approximately 10 minutes before she called 911 from her home phone at 64 Beachside Drive. Upon arrival, I observed Miss Mallowan in a frantic state, along with her 4-year-old son, Benson Mallowan. Miss Mallowan claimed to see a white male with black hair, approximately 5'9", walking along the beach 15 minutes prior to the incident. There was no sign of this unidentified male upon my arrival. No other witnesses were on the beach at the time. Miss Mallowan had taken pictures with a disposable camera minutes before the disappearance, which she provided to the investigators. The photographs may contain evidence of individuals or witnesses around the area at the time of the disappearance and will be developed immediately and reviewed. The missing boy was last seen wearing a He-Man t-shirt, gray sweatpants, and red Bludson Bay sweatshirt. Additional officers and a search and rescue team were called in to perform an initial sweep of the beach. A red sweatshirt matching the description was recovered in the surf by the mother. Child presumed dead from drowning. Chapter 1. Ginger Mallowan. June 27th, 1986. I couldn't see the man's face through the veil of twilight closing on Bludson Bay Beach, but I could feel his stare. The stranger had been following me and the boys along the surf as we walked toward 64 Beachside Drive, our humble clapboard home that sat beyond a large sand dune on the 6th block. Not far up ahead, our dilapidated boardwalk jutted out, cutting through the grassy mounds, and I quickened my step. As a single mother with two rambunctious boys, I doubted my shadower wanted to take my breath away following a proper date. Considering my poor taste in men, I was better off dancing with myself to Billy Idol anyway. The way the man followed just far enough behind to blend in with the dusk, but still keeping up with my increasing pace, this stranger was up to no good. I could feel it in my bones. A vicious gust of wind ripped the beach bag from my hand, spilling the leftovers of our picnic dinner across the sand. Benny and Cole scampered ahead together, chasing seagulls that had descended on the food scraps, while I chased a flying Tupperware lid. I smiled as I watched them play, each clutching their action figures, Hulk Hogan for Benny and Optimus Prime Transformer for Cole. Their matching He-Man shirts blended in with the night. I remembered being terrified to raise boys after their births, cradling each one's tiny pink body, wondering how I could nurture them to be better men than their father. It didn't take long for each of them to become a moon to my tide, pulling me with a maternal force. They were mine, and I was theirs, so I willingly gave myself over to them, and them to me. Since then, I couldn't imagine anything different. My boys were my boys. They were my whole life and made my life whole. Benny, Cole, don't wander too far. It's getting dark. I glanced behind me, but the man was gone, as far as I could tell. Daylight was too scarce to know for sure.
Mummy, goose!
Benny shrieked with delight, pointing to the seagulls.
Mummy, goose!
Cole parroted his older brother. While almost 3 years separated the brothers in age, Benny's language development had recently become severely delayed. Our physician speculated that it could be the newly popular diagnosis of autism, a disorder that remained a mystery to me, and our doctor as well, it seemed. Though I blamed the disappearing act of Benny's father 6 months ago. The day his dad left was the day Benny stopped talking. It took every bit of effort to coax him to speak, and what words did come out were more befitting of his year-and-a-half-old brother. I was doing the best I could under the circumstances. At least, that's what I told myself when the sense of failure crept in. A particularly daring seagull swooped down, picking up one of the mustard-yellow container lids. Shooing it away, I chased down the rest of the Tupperware that had flipped across the beach, collecting everything back in my straw Bermuda bag. A zap of lightning cracked the sky far down the shore, briefly illuminating the endless stretch of horizon. I caught a glimpse of a herd of wild horses that roamed the coastline, the only true natives that remained here. A distant whinny told me even the Mustangs knew better than to stick around for the storm. A rip of thunder echoed, and based on my counting, the storm was about 4 Mississippis away. In other words, about 4 miles, giving us about 10 minutes to take cover. A gust yanked on my color block windbreaker. I slipped on my neon pink jelly shoes I had been carrying and held out the tiny red sweatshirt I'd bought from Wing's beachwear shop. Cole, come here, honey. It's getting cold, bud. Let mommy put this on you. I grabbed his wrist as he tried to skirt around me and pulled the sweatshirt over his head, threading his arms through each sleeve.
No!
Cole screamed, wriggling against the shirt. He hated long sleeves almost as much as I hated fighting him over long sleeves. When Cole's head popped through the neck of the shirt, he patted the tender spot on his forehead where he had scraped the skin in a tumble on the pavement earlier this week. It was already starting to scab over into a heart-shaped scar.
Kiss Ellie,
Cole insisted. I brushed my lips against the boo-boo, then kissed all over his face as he tugged up the hem of the shirt. Just wear it until we get inside. I waved Benny over. One quick picture of you two boys before we head in.
Mummy, no picture!
They both whined. I'll be quick, I promise. The diaper duo, so nicknamed because Benny had yet to potty train and Cole still had a ways to go, struck a silly pose while I lifted the Kodak Instamatic I'd brought with me. The flash blinded them for a moment, but capturing those cute smiles was worth torturing them. Freeing them to go play, for 5 minutes, then inside, I dropped the camera in my bag as a flurry whipped my hair in a frenzied halo. Benny, stay with your little brother while I put this away, I reminded him.
Okay, Mommy.
Then Benny tapped Cole in an impromptu game of tag.
Hey, you guys!
He screamed as he took off.
Hey, you guys!
Cole echoed. The boys had worn out their VHS copy of The Goonies, and both could do a pretty decent imitation of Sloth's signature line. The yellow glow of the back porch light guided me to where the boardwalk met the sand. I dropped the beach bag on the wooden planks and turned back to find the boys. By now it was nearly pitch black as I blindly called for them. Benny! Cole! Come on in, boys! The storm's coming! The wind was too loud to hear my own voice, let alone their reply. I fought the gale with each step as I searched the shore for my son.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.